السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الحمد لله، brothers and sisters. الحمد لله، الله تعالى has really blessed us again with Sheikh Samer al-Nas. Sheikh Samer, really, we are fortunate to have a scholar of this caliber talk to us about such an important topic, al-maqasid. Al-maqasid is a topic that overshadows many others. I mean, the title itself it explains that very well. The purpose of divine law. That is indeed a great topic, requires a great man to talk about it. And alhamdulillah, we have one of the foremost scholars to talk about this topic to us. And I just wanted to quickly go over the timeline. We're running late, and I apologize about that. So the timeline for today's event, we're going to continue on to 11:30. We'll take a break at 11:30 for 10 minutes. And then afterwards, we're going to continue for session two, we'll go on to Dhuhr. So from 1:10 to 2:30, we'll take a Dhuhr and lunch break. And then we'll return for I think two more sessions, or three more sessions, yes. As you can see up on the timeline. And this will be the timeline for our event today. And without any further delay, I'd like to request from our Sheikh, or give him the podium so that he can begin. Jazakumullah khairan wa iyyakum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد الأولين والآخرين معلم الخير وقائد الخير ورسول الرحمة اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الغر الميامين وصحبه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وفقهنا إذا علمتنا اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا. First point which I pay my attention to it, you know, you have in between Arabic and English in the title itself, you know, and this is my mistake, completely my mistake. In Arabic we said al-maqasid, in English we said the purposes of divine law. You see the difference? Okay. And here, when you say al-maqasid, you are going to open it for everyone, you know, to take whatever he wants to take, to do whatever he wants to do. And what paid my attention that even Imam al-Shatibi, who was one of the first one to speak deeply, you know, about maqasid, he did not say al-maqasid, he said maqasid al-shara', okay? And it's very, very important point to have it as such. Don't say al-maqasid. This is my mistake, okay? Say maqasid al-shara', okay? Al-maqasid, when we say al-maqasid, everyone has some interest. Regardless, you know, you cannot have any alive person, you know, without having an interest. Okay, here we speak about al-shara', what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Okay, and this is very important point. And here you have two components of the title. You have maqasid and you have shara'.
Maqasid al-shara', and this is the title by Imam Shatibi. Okay, when you say maqasid means purposes. When you say al-shara', this is a way of practicing your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is my definition to religion. Whenever you say religion, it means how you are going to practice with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this relation, as any relation in this life, it comes from two sides. The first and the most and the greatest side is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sign, and the other one is the servant sign, the sign. And here, since you have a domination, you have a dominant sign, most of these relations, they are going to be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his slave. Okay? And this is maybe summarized by the verse in Surah Al-Fatiha, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. And this summarizes the duty you have toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the things that we ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has been summarized here as a help. You seek the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say maqasid al-shara, that's mean what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want from us. Okay? Maqasid, when you say maqasid, everyone has. He wants something to be achieved. Okay. I should highlight, even though this has is not direct to my talk, you know, but I should highlight certain texts, you know, firstly from the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you may hate something which is beneficial to you. You may, this is verse number 116 in Surah Al-Baqarah. You may hate something which is beneficial to you. You may like something which is harmful to you. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُ. Allah knows, you don't know. Okay? And this is really to not to suppress or take away our purposes here, but to make it as secondary of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. Okay? Yani when we know, when we are absolutely knowledgeable one, we are going to be primary. But here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us as such, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ, you may hate something like that. And this verse, then it was ended, you know, and you have this end, you know, in many verses, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. That's mean Allah knows, you don't know. Okay? That's mean you are going to have it secondary, okay? And you are going to find in particular what Imam Shatibi did say about maqasid, he made it secondary to the regulation and rules were set up by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you have in the Hadith al-Nabawi al-Sharif, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as narrated by Sayyidina Ubad al-Mustamid, he used to give bay'ah to have complete obedience, whether you like it or you hate it. Fil manshati wal makrah. Okay? And this is means that I may have some maqasid, I have something inside myself, okay, as purposes, as benefit for me or whatever, and I may feel that when I obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this particular point, I'm going to go over my benefit, over my interest, and they used to give bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have complete obedience in two aspects, and this is very important. The third one, this was narrated in Bukhari, that Abu Zinad. Who is Abu Zinad? Abu Zinad, I think he's from the senior, from the junior successors. They said he is the one who collected all that has come from Fuqaha al-Saba, who were the major Fuqaha al-Madinah al-Munawwara. They were seven. That he collected all of their knowledge and data in himself, Abu Zinad. What did he say, Abu Zinad? As related in Bukhari. He said, I'm going to mention it in Arabic and try to translate it. إِنَّ السُّنَنَ وَوُجُوهَ الْحَقْ لَتَأْتِي كَثِيرًا عَلَى خِلَافِ الرَّأِيِ فَمَا يَجِدُ الْمُسْلِمُونَ بُدًّا مِنْ اتِّبَاعِهِ. You may have the traditions narrated from the Prophet ﷺ and those right possibilities. What does he mean by right possibilities? You see, you have some people, they interpret the Quran the right way or the truthful way, and some they interpret it the otherwise way. That's why he said wujuhul haqq. Okay, that means when you try to interpret, when you try to understand it the way it should be understood, it may come
in many occasions against your opinion or against what you think about it. So when you have it, al-Muslimun, those who are followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, namely followers of the Holy Quran and the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they don't have any other choice except to follow it. Okay? يعني here, this is one of the main difference between the section that we belong to, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and the other sections. You may have other sections that they give priority to their understanding over the text, okay? Namely, they are Al-Mu'tazila, okay? You have a subsection among Ahlul Sunnah. They are considered from Ahlul Sunnah. They deny the whole subject today. They don't have maqasid at all. They don't say anything, namely they are al-Zahiriyya. Al-Zahiriyya, they don't try to give any explanation or any logical analysis for any of those texts, you know, and by this, they are considered some a part of Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, our section, but they differ, you know, they have main difference, you know, with the people in this regard. Okay. So here, firstly, the target should be maqasid al-shara. I'm sorry, this was my mistake. Second thing, to define it. What's the meaning of maqasid al-shara as defined by Imam Shatibi? That this religion, these regulations, they were put to the benefit of the servants, you know, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you have in the Quran and in the prophetic tradition, many of these texts, they give the reason behind it. Namely, you have كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Why? What's the purpose behind it? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initiate to give you the reason behind it. Then, وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ. In the same page you have three times. وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Okay? يعني when you practice your fasting of Ramadan and then you celebrate the Eid al-Fitr, you may be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Just give it the reason behind it. The verse behind it, after it. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَالِي عَلَىٰ. Then at the end of it, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُ بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. They may be guided by this. These are the verses, you know, in the page, yeah, they are from verse number 184 to verse number 186, or 83, let's say, 183 to verse number 86. You have in three of these verses, you know, who are four. These are four verses, you know. You have three of them, they have the reason behind it, okay. You have it in many of the ahadith. The Prophet ﷺ, when he said he prohibited to have the person get married to the aunt of his wife or to the niece of his wife, he said because this may interrupt or cut the family relation, okay. He gave the reason behind it, okay. And you find it, you have many of those aspects in Sharia, you have the reason behind them. This reason may be mentioned by some of the, may be mentioned by the Holy Quran or the prophetic tradition. The rest of it may not be mentioned thoroughly. It will be given, you know, by some of the scholars or the others. Okay? And this is very important. Here, you have another point, they highlighted a lot. Okay? All Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, they highlighted it. You have what called in Arabic al-illah and al-hikmah. Qiyas, analogy, it goes by illah, not by hikmah. I give you an example of it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the excuse to break fast or not to fast during traveling, okay, this is traveling is considered as illa, the reason behind it, okay, this is the reason. Al-hikmah, they said, because of hardship,
or difficulty. Okay? This is the wisdom behind it. See the difference? And here, in many aspects of Islam, you may have the real reason which cannot be defined physically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will set up some physical measurement to define this. Okay? And that's why you have this mismatch, you know, between the reason and the wisdom. Okay? The wisdom, you found some books, you know, speak about wisdom, you know, in Islam. In my library, I have a very small book, you know, just like this, you know, speaking about it. Whereas for Illah, you have plenty of books, you know, speaking about it. You see, and here, in our mind, we should have the differentiation between reason and wisdom, okay? Illah and Hikmah. Why? Because Fuqaha, in most cases, they build their rules and their answers according to the reason, not according to the wisdom behind it. The wisdom, you may understand it, you may be right about it, and you may be wrong about it. Example about the same thing that I gave, when you break fast, you know, during traveling, you have the king when he travels, you know, is going to be in much more luxurious setting than the ordinary man or the poor man, you know, when he did not travel. Yet, okay, he has the full right to break his fast, the king, but that poor person, you know, if he did not have any hardship, you know, in this regard, he cannot break his fast. You got it, this point? And here, sometimes, this is the exception according to those people who speak about maqasid, who speak about reasoning and whatever. Sometimes you may have mismatch. And they will go by the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designated, even though you may find in some cases that it's going to be too hard and too difficult, but it's not going to be impossible for sure. If any point is not clear, please write it down, inshallah, I'll try to answer it at the end. So here, this was the definition of Imam Shafi'i, that this Sharia, this religion was put for the benefit of the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why you have the reason mentioned in many of these verses and in many of the prophetic statements, you know, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This about the definition, okay? And I would like to say maqasid al-sharia, not absolutely maqasid, okay? Because al-maqasid, then you came to some other matters, you know, and we showed the mismatch, okay? Yeah, maqasid al-sharia, that's mean what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. Maqasid, I may have some interest different than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. You may have this, the other may have that, you know, and this is the main difference, you know, between maqasid al-shari' and al-maqasid in general. Then, this has been agreed on, you know, by everyone, that you have these five, and they are mentioned in your handout. These are the main things that you should keep them up. And this is, you may look at them as one of the purpose of your Sharia, to keep up first. And they are in this order, okay? Firstly, your religion. Secondly, yourself, your life. Thirdly, your intellect. And fourth, here it may be translated like reputation or like lineage, okay? Both of them, they are of maqasid sharia, to keep up your reputation and your lineage. And lastly, your money or your wealth, okay? These are maqasid sharia. From where did you get this? When you recite the Quran from the beginning till the end, you are going to find many verses in the Quran give the importance of these five items by one way or another. Okay, this is going to be repetitively mentioned in the Holy Quran. And this is the benefit you take of it, you take from it that it is highly recommended, highly important, you know, in your religion. And it may be in the positive way or in the negative way. What I mean by positive or negative way, it may come as keep up this matter and this the positive way, it may come in the negative way when you have any of them abused or malpractice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemn these people. From both piles of data that you have, the positive one and the negative one, you are going to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means to keep up your religion, to keep up your life, and you keep up, and you name it, all of this. And this is as as has been mentioned by many of our scholars, this is not only in Islam, in all religions come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may find in other religions, you know, they may ask you to kill yourself or this or that, you know. But all religions came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Namely, the religions came before Islam by the prophets from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are considered, you know, in all of these aspects. Some may say, how come they are as such, you know, and we read in Quran that Sayyidina Musa instructed his people to kill themselves. Yeah, this is mentioned in Quran. What's the answer? When we said it's in this order, they have done something wrong in their religion, will not be fixed unless by killing themselves. Okay? Yani here, you are going to spend, you are going to lose, you are going to have it in an account, some of those lower for something for which is in the upper order that you have in this world. Another point about them, they said the first one, the mainstay of it, first one, the religion, they are ibadat, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For sure, in indirect way, you may worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by gaining money, by keeping up your health and whatever. But the main one, you see, yani here you should have whatever has been asked to be fixed by the primary order, and what has been fixed as a secondary order. Okay? Yani as we know in Islam, وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Whenever you have good intention, you are going to be rewarded for many of the ordinary activity done by someone else. And by this broad meaning of ibadat, you may include all of them, you know, consider all of them as ibadat. But they are not ibadat as a primary. They became ibadat by your intention. Okay? And here we should have full recognition between what is in primary they are ibadat, and namely the Prophet ﷺ name of them five, to testimony that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, to set up your prayer, pay your charity as an obligation, and fast Ramadan and perform your Hajj to Holy Kaaba. Okay? Here, these are the primary one to cover the first aspect of your ibadah. Okay? And this is even the fuqaha in their books, they call it the quarter of ibadah. Okay? Whereas the others, when you have good intention, you know, by getting married, you are going to be rewarded according to the Prophet ﷺ, as mentioned in the authentic hadith. But this is not your it's not limited to you. Even the non-Muslim may get married, the non-Muslim may earn money, the non-Muslim may do this. But your good intention, you will change it from a habitual matter to ibadah, to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So here, again, please have in your mind what is primary and what's secondary. Okay? Why? Because as you may know, the primary one has the superiority over the secondary one. Okay, that's why Imam Shafi'i said that the one who has the ability to keep himself, you know, away of sinful action, it's better for him not to get married. Okay, yani here he did not deny the other issues here, but he, even though marriage may be considered as ibadah, part of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's not as primary as the other matters, you know, has been mentioned here. So, Imam Shatibi, he put the ibadat as the first one, okay, adat, habitual matter, for the second and Third one, usually by the habit, okay? Everyone, all humankind, they try to protect themselves, you know. When I have very high light, I'm going to cover my eyes, okay? This is a natural. So many of those protective measurements that we take toward ourselves and toward our intellect, they are habitual, you know, by definition. Then you have the last two to keep up your lineage and reputation and to keep up your money. This needs what? The contracts, or we call them mu'amalat, okay? Mu'amalat, this include the money contracts, you know, all of them, you know, sale and buying and others, you know, and it contains, you know, the marital laws, you know, which has been set up in the Holy Quran. So here, this is a rough estimation about having of these five items, how they relate to the quarters that we mention in our Islam, okay? As you may see, the first one relate to the first quarter of ibadah. The last two, they relate to two quarters of them. We subdivide them to ritual laws and money contracts, okay? Whereas the number two and three, they are related to the habitual matter, you know, which may be by habit. This, the mainstay of them, even though you may have some interaction between them, you know, as we said before, okay? And this is perhaps the most important point, you know, about the whole subject, okay? These are the five items that you are entitled, you are obliged to keep up them, okay? And your religion is the first one, you know, to concentrate and to speak about it. First one, I mean, yani, among ourselves, yani, when we have certain books or whatever. But on the other hand, you have the previous religions, all of them, they concentrate on these five different items, you know, in different way. And for each item of these five, you have the three sub types, you know, of it, or the types of it, which they are daruriya, hajiya, tahsini. Okay? Yani here you may have something necessary or something needed or something just to make it better. Okay. That's translated as perfection, improvement. Okay. Some scholars, they said, when you have this in your mind, you are going to have like a net, okay, of 15 different items. Okay? I just imagine you have a table of five, and you put the three columns, necessity, need, or improvement. Okay? And by this, you are going to have 15 possibilities. And by this, you are going to cover most of the matters we are going to speak about. You got this point? Yani here, when you put it in a table, shall I write it down for you? Improvement. like you are going to have 15 different possibilities, you know, applicable for everyone. Then you should have the common, as we said, the importance, it goes down here by this way. Okay? What I mean by this, you should sacrifice your words, you know, for your life. And it's quite obvious, you know, even the normal person is going to do so. And again here, they go by this way. And this, the importance is going to be less, you know, when you go back down. And that's why it has been summarized that the need and the improvement, they are servants of the necessity. The necessity is the original one. And this is, as anything you know in Islam, you have the core, the base is supported by something which is less important than it, and then supported by something else, you know, which is much less important than it. Example of it, as in Hanafi they said, you have the obligation, okay? They say the obligation of your prayer, they are supported by the compulsory, they are supported by the tradition or the sunnah that you have. You see, yeah, this is the way. And this is even by the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that hereafter, the one who missed some portion of his obligation, they are going to be completed from where? From the other, okay? And here, you may have it in the same way. Whenever you have missing part there, in the core, they are going to be completed from the first circle, then the second circle, and you name it, okay? Just imagine it in this way, you know, and this is going to be quite helpful for all of us, you know, to imagine what we mean by maqasid al-shara, okay? And these are maqasid al-shara put in the two ways. What do we mean by necessity? We mean by necessity, whenever this is going to, they have a very nice word here, I'm going to use it exactly. Okay, you should have two components. First, to set it up and prevent of vanishing or going. Okay, and again, here you have the positive and negative component of it. Okay, set it up, that means to do it. Okay, prevent it, that means to have the measurement not to be taken away by one way or another. Okay, and this is, you should look at it in the both component, the component of making it up, and this is most of them. You see, here we should be careful. Some may expect that all obligations they are going to be here, and here also that they are going to be, not necessary. For sure, obligations they are going to be here, but you may have some obligation even here. I'm going to give example of it, okay? So here, this is the first one may be considered as obligation, and the other one as prohibition, okay? And this is applicable for all of them. Each one we should keep it up, and we should prevent anything that may make it go away or vanish. Okay, and by this, and you may give its example here, you are prohibited to commit kufr, okay? You should set it up, you know, by saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Again, you should protect yourself, you know, of having anything to be killed, you know, by or whatever, or to refrain eating, you know, which is going to kill you or whatever, and you should protect yourself of the matter. And you mean to go by it. All matters. You see, you got this point, and here you have two components of each one of them. One is positive and one is negative. The second one is not as such. You may keep up, but it has some hardship or difficulty. Okay? You are going to suffer a lot, you know, to keep it up. Here, it's not exactly necessity. And I would like to highlight this point a lot, you know, because many of us, they misunderstand the difference between necessity and needs. We may think about something which is quite luxurious or quite not needed, you know, as necessity. I'll give you an example about it. One time I was praying, you know, back in Syria, and a person asked the Imam of the mosque, you know, while I was praying, you know, about kafara. You know, the kafara is to fast 60 executive days. And he said, I cannot do. He said, then you feed 60 persons. When I finished my prayer, I asked him, do you fast Ramadan? He said, for sure, yes, I fast Ramadan. Okay. I said, then in my mind, the one who has the ability to fast Ramadan has the ability to fast 60 consecutive days. You see, yani here, the first answer you are going to get from many of us, I cannot do it. You see, that's why I feel nowadays we try to broaden the meaning of necessity. We shouldn't broaden it this way, okay? It should be limited to its, as we said here, okay? To set it up and not let it go, you know, or vanish. These are the main matter. When you have it with hardship, for sure, he may have hardship, you know, to do the expiation or kafara or whatever, you know, but this is not necessity by any way. So here, when you have, I'm going to give some examples, you know, about it. When you have hardship or difficulty, it's a need. Here they say, when you have trivial of it or not, trivial hardship or difficulty or not, yani, this just to be much more good looking, okay? So here, example of it. When someone, whenever he fasts, is going to die, the physician told him as such, this is necessity to break his fast. When he's going to achieve fasting, but reach the end of the day with full of the exhaustion, you know, and a lot of difficulty and hardship, this is what? This is a need, okay? When he has a trivial thirsty or hunger or tiredness, you know, this is improvement. You see, this is the example of it. Okay. What's the difference between them? Those who are prohibited, prohibitions, you cannot go over them unless you have a necessity. The one who is about to die, you tell him to eat pork. This is prohibited. And this is mentioned in the Quran. Okay? This is a Quranic statement. Okay? The one who is about to die, you tell him to eat pork. Or to eat dead animal, or this or that. Okay? But only the necessity it works for those who are prohibited matters. Okay? When you come to obligation, you have the two possibilities. It may be necessity or need. When you have someone, as we said before, going to be completely exhausted, you know, at the end of the day, he has the right to break his fast. When you ever have a sick person, when you ever have a traveler, when you have expectation of having hardship or whatever, or difficulty, then he has the right to break his fast. You see this point? And here, you look at them in two steps. The step of prohibition, and this is, you cannot break it unless you have some necessity, as mentioned in the Quran. And we have the step of obligation, and this may be broken by the first one and the second one, which is the need, okay? For sure, for number three, you are not going to break any obligation or prohibition in that regard, okay? And this is all taken from the prophetic statement when he said, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. I think this mutawatir hadith according to Imam Suyuti, and this said that whatever I prohibit, you should avoid it. Whatever I command to do, you do whatever you have the ability to do. And here the difference in expression, you know, about the prohibition and commands, made the fuqaha understand the difference between prohibition and obligation in the first item and the second item. Okay, these are very important points that they should be well known, you know, to all of us. Okay, and we should practice according to them. Okay, as I said before, you may have some of these improvement and they are obligation. Okay, like what? Wudu is obligation. Wudu is something to make you much more nice, you know, when you wash, or when you have ghusl, you know, or whatever, you know, or when you have purified clothes, you know, to clean clothes, to pray with him, you know, all of this, they may be looked at as improvement, okay, but they are obligation. So here, I don't want anyone to misunderstand this point, okay, that some may feel that in obligation, they are going to be limited to the first item. No, you may have it in the first one, you may have it in the second one, and you may have it in the third one, okay, but we look at them as they are servants. The second, number two and number three, they are servants to Allah. Okay? That's why the fuqaha, they said, you may have some certain circumstances that you are incapable of doing wudu or tayammum. What you are going to do? Are you going to miss your prayer? No, you pray. Okay? Yani here, they are servants. And you feel it in this way. Whereas when the woman she is in the menstruation, we don't ask her to make wudu. See the difference? You see her? Yeah, here, when someone is incapable of doing prayer, he's of no need of making wudu. When someone is incapable of making wudu, he should make his salah. You see the difference? And this is the meaning of that they are servant of the first one. And I gave two examples how when you miss the first, the one which is important, you are going to cancel the others, and when you miss this one, you are not going to cancel the original one. And don't take only the example, you may apply to all of those needs that we mentioned, you know, about the 15 different possibilities. This is, I think, the bulk of our talk. This is very important. Think about it a lot. If anyone has any question about it, write it down. I don't know when we are going to answer the question, okay? And if you want me to speak further about it, I'm going to speak. But let's have some question, you know, because this perhaps has to do it for the desk.
Just
the last
point,
please. What last one?
The last point about...
The last point I spoke about. You may expect to have obligation or prohibition here or there. Okay? Yani it may be felt that you will not have obligation, you are going to have only sunnah or offensive matter. No, you may have it in that three aspects. But generally, look, you have that these two, they are servant of the first one. And I gave an example of it. I'm going to repeat the same example. When you have someone without water or soil to perform tayammum or wudu, he should make his prayer. Okay? And here, missing this last portion, you are not going to miss the first one. Okay? Whereas when you have woman menstruating, you know, that means she is not obliged to pray, she is not going to make wudu.
So wudu,
wudu may be considered in the improvement, just to look, you know, with nice smell and look. These are very important points, and I think all of us should understand it very well. Okay? Yes?
So, I don't know if I understood this correctly. If something is haram, you would need a darura to break it?
Yes. And you need darura. After, under the needs, you cannot break the haram.
Okay. And if something is obligation, if it's haja, you can break it?
Yes.
Okay. And now, for tahsiniya, it doesn't break anything.
Doesn't. No. That's the improvement one doesn't break haram, prohibition, or obligation. Yes, you are right.
Within the hajat, like the difficulty, would there be different types like shadida?
The shadida is here in needs, the trivial one is here in improvement. Because for sure, all of us, you know, whenever we fast, we are going to find ourselves, you know, have something different, okay? But this is this trivial and purable, that's why we have this one. When it became tough, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the traveler or the sick one or the old one, then it became different too.
Is there a wusta also, like the little, there's a little difficulty?
You want to make wusta, you know, I don't know, they did not mention it, you know. This wusta, you may have some fuqaha who consider it as a need, the other they may consider it as improved. Okay, and that's why all these matters, you may have controversy about it. Yes?
Is there a pattern as to how the lower in priority of the maqasid, like life and wealth, regarding the needed and improvements that fall under, you know, for those categories, how they compare to the ones above it?
In the same thing, you know, in the need and improvement or in the necessity?
Comparing the needs and improvements of the lower maqasids to the necessary of the ones above it. I mean,
for sure it's going to be much stronger, right?
Yeah, here, yes.
Opposite all the way around. Here you should consider, يعني, look at them, you know. I think the necessity comes at first for the five of them, you know. Yeah, this order just to give preference to one over the other. Okay, but not to have the need and improvement to have interference. No, the need and improvement, generally speaking, even if they are for religious matter, you know, they are not going to overcome, you know, what is necessary for your mind or whatever. And that's why, okay, yani here, as a religious person, you shouldn't eat pork, okay, but to save your life, you have the right to eat it. See, and here this is an example, you know, of how you give the priority to the second one or third one whenever you have necessity over the need or improvement from the first one.
So eating pork be considered a improvement of religion?
No.
For sure. When you look at the society nowadays, you see it quite often in some societies, you know, and communities, okay? For religion, it's as such, but for life, it's for survival. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Is someone often, if they choose not to eat pork, and they'd rather...
Yes, they said he is athen. This is not the case all the time, okay? They said when someone giving the offer to make kufr or to be killed, it's better not to give kufr. That's what they say. Even though he is excused and he may make kufr, okay? And they have some difference, you know, about those matters, you know, how we are going to deal with it. And that's why, even when, according to most scholars, when someone giving the offer to be killed or to have illegal relation, which is number four here, he said he is going to be killed, you know, and not have this illegal relation. Other men.
Would it be required?
Wallahi, according to the Hanafi resources, I don't know about the other Muslims, he is sinful. You know. The only scholar among Hanafi who said he is not sinful is Qadi Khan. But the rest, all of them, they said he is sinful if he choose to commit whatever he, you know, to save his life. Yes?
Afwan Sheikh, what about the category where a person is permitted to speak kufr in order
okay.
to save their life?
This is a very important point. Okay. When you speak kufr, is kufr and belief is in your tongue? It's in your heart, okay? That's why, yani here you did not miss your religion. You see, this is a very important point. When we say kufr, even though I shouldn't say kufr now, you know, when I'm in the secure and peaceful circumstances. But when someone say kufr, this doesn't mean that he became kafir. Well, and this is what it has been illustrated very well in the Quran. وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ Okay? يعني that's why they said, you are going to save your life. You are permitted, not obliged. You are permitted to save your life by saying kufr. Why? This is not against the rule. Why? Because he did not put down your religion. You're still believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a very important point. Okay? يعني here, to have it by tongue doesn't mean that your heart became as such.
Yes.
So can you explain how, because the state of your life in that case would be, what would that be considered? It would be, isn't that Laura and then to do, I don't know why wouldn't it be obligatory?
It's not obligatory.
Because you're not destroying your religion.
Because even though you kept your religion, but here the religion is going to humidify, you know, by this, okay? It's going to be put down, and you have some way of getting over the religion. That's why they said you have the choice, but it's better to be killed, you know, than to have this done.
And for religion, would that be
darura
for religion too? Is that why they give you a choice?
For sure, it's darura for life because he's about to be killed. But for religion, as they related in our experience, they said, even though in the ordinary way it's going to be considered kufr, when someone commits kufr by his tongue, he's going to be treated as kafir. But here in this case, he will not be as such. As you may remember, in fiqh, you have many of the matters you speak up about them, they are going to be considered, and many they will not be considered. Okay. And here when you have these circumstances, this is not going to be considered. Okay. And namely you have ikrah or forceful kufr, this is not going to be considered. Same like when you have a contract of sale or contract of renting or whatever of those regards, all of those matters, they are not going to be considered as real ones. They are fake. Why? Because of the circumstances. Whereas when you fail to prove that this was the circumstances, they are going to be considered as real. And here you have the same thing.
Okay. So to understand correctly, so they would both, if every example you have, you would be able to fit it in the chart, correct?
You should.
And with, for example, this exception or this note that you would say that, you know,
this you may look at it as exceptional, and you may not look at it as exceptional. Why? Because as I said, you did not lose your religion. You still have full belief, and that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُّ بِالْإِيمَانِ. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlighted that verse, it means that for belief and religion, it's in your heart, not in your tongue. Even though for the ordinary man, it may be considered as kufr.
So the note, the shahada, is would be from the Taqsimiyyat?
This controversial issue. You read it in Aqeedah.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
You read it in Aqeedah, and this is, I think, the first one to speak about it was Imam Ghazali. In my mind, I may be wrong, you know, that is it necessary to nutqu shahada for this life? It is necessary. No doubt. No one would say that it's not necessary. Whenever anyone offered to have it, and he refrained, again, it's a must. The case when someone did not be offered it, you know, for sure in Ahkam al-Din is going to be looked at as kafir. In the hereafter, you have the controversy between Imam al-Ghazali and the other. See? Make sure. This is in the hereafter, not in this life. Yes?
Do the knees, if they amma al-balwa, do they raise up to the level of the ruba? It's like for the whole society, it affects the needs of the society, or even the taqsimiyyat.
Taqsimiyyat for sure is not going to be considered as the ruba. Okay? For needs, they said some fuqaha, some of those who said the rules, they said al-hajiyat taqum maqam daruriyat. But this is the way I understood it from studying from different resources. You should take it as an exception, not as a rule. Okay? And here, if we consider it as a rule, as some speakers they make it, you know, you are going to break the whole difference, you know, between necessity and needs. And you should build it, okay? Yani here, under certain circumstances or consideration, some of these needs may be looked at as necessity. But to have it as a rule, no, it's completely wrong. Because by this, you are not differentiating between the first column and the second column. Yes.
This is, it's not much before the
As I said, this is one of the qa'idah of Ahnaf, of not absolute. Okay? Yani this, when you take it as an absolute one, you are completely wrong. Okay? Because even the Ahnaf, they spoke about how to limit it, you know, or how to regulate it. And as you may know, if you are familiar with the qawa'id of Ahnaf, almost all qawa'id in Hanafi Mazhab, they have exceptions.
Right. But so was it regulated by just saying that if it's
or not
removed, they talk about they removed the general.
Umum al-balwa, not in all cases. Okay? In the cases that I'm not quite sure now to speak about, but I know that it's for special cases, not everything.
So there's some hajat that are umum, but they're not considered from clothes.
That's right, yes.
No.
Okay.
Are all these sections, the Dhuhr, Hajjat, and Tahsinat, they have all positive and negative? Like the what you mentioned for the Dhuhr?
For sure, for sure. Yeah, to keep up your wudu, not to miss your wudu, okay. Or have the factor to miss your wudu, and you name it, yes. And all of them, you should look at them from the positive and negative aspect of it. Yes?
If the prohibition of riba, if we put it under the Dhuhr in religion, can anything below it override the prohibition of riba?
No, here, you are expanding the meaning of it. Religion means your belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Yani to, for sure we are going to be regulated. Here you have many religious commands and prohibitions. Here you have many religious that you see. Yani in each one you are going to have those. Because as we said at the title, Maqasid al-Shari'ah, all of these matters, they are religious in this matter. Okay? But they are not direct, as I said. Okay? The direct one, the quarter of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The rest, they may be looked at in secondary way, not in the primary way. And it's very important point here to differentiate between the primary and the secondary one. Yes?
How is needed understood in respect to lineage and or is it just reputation?
And here when you have someone may commit zina, okay? This is like, and here it's for lineage and reputation as we said, okay? So the need of them, you said, yeah, when you have, let's say in society, you have a massive war, you know, and most of the males, they are gone, you know, as happened, you know, in some communities. You may look at it as a need or sometimes a necessity. You see? And again, nikah per se, if you accept, with the exception of the Shafi'i Mazhab, is considered as need. As need, yes. Okay.
And 5 minutes to break.
Okay, 5 minutes to break. Okay. One of the important thing, whenever you have something tahsin or need, it shouldn't go and take away the necessity one. Okay? Example of it. You want to make wudu and you are about to have the time over, you know. Rather than making sunnah of the wudu and 3 times over there, you should hurry up, you should rush. Okay? Yeah, you shouldn't have the improvement or the need take over the necessity or the basic one, okay? The salah here namely, okay? And in many other aspects, okay? When you have something good for the life, you know, when you have, let's say the food is halal, you know, and if you wait, you are going to have a slot of meat, you know, but if you are if someone is going to die, this shouldn't get take over the one, okay? And this is the general rule. The general rule, you shouldn't have the improvement or the need take over the necessity. Okay? And this is, يعني, as you may see it, is looking at them as a priorities. The way the arrow go here and the way the arrow go there, okay? This you look at them as priorities. Okay, and you shouldn't have any of the lower one or the left one
compromise the one in the right side or the upper limit, you know, because you look at them in a priority. And among them, this ahsinat, according to many scholars, this is not applicable in all madhhabs. Here in tahsin, you have what we call sadd al-zara'i. Okay? We are going to speak about it much more later on, but sadd al-zara'i, it means when you have something permitted, but when you do it, it's going to lead to something harm. We have a proof about it in the Quran. Yes, we have a proof in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَسُبُّوا الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونَ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّوا اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Okay? And this is سد الزرائع. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited us of curse or condemning their gods because they are going to condemn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? This is something halal which led to something illegal, okay, and this is called sadd al-zara'i. Most of these sadd al-zara'i that are going to be looked at among those who really take good care of them as improvement, you know. In our mazhabs, you know, the Maliki and after it the Hanbali, they look at it in very strong way, the way of sadd al-zara'i. The Hanafi and Shafi'i, they are not that good, you know, in taking care of these sadd al-zara'i. They don't care or they don't consider them a lot, you know, as the Hanafi and as the Maliki and Hanbali. Okay? And by this, as anything in this life, you may divide sadd al-zara'i into three categories. One is muhaqqaq or definite, and one is zanni. And this is doubt, not doubtful, possibility. And you have waham, which is less than doubtful. And if I want to put them in number, this 100%, and this is above 50%, and this less than 50%. Okay? For sure, this is going to be considered among all scholars, including Shafi'i and Hanafi, and this is going to be excluded among all scholars, even Hanbali and Maliki. And this one, here we have the bulk or the room that you have different opinion about it. You got this point? And here, when you speak about sadd al-zara'i', you cannot say completely is wrong or completely is right, okay? Because you have something mentioned in the Quran, something mentioned in the Hadith, and this has been considered by all scholars, you know, or all madhhabs, as something that you should work to have it, you know. Whereas, you have something, you know, it's not considered at all, even by the Maliki or the Hanbali. When I buy something from you, you know, I'm 100% sure that this is not stolen or not got to you by illegal way. No, but when I have that, this is as low possibility, you know, less than 50%, then it's not considered, okay? Even according to Hanbali and Maliki Madhab. Whereas in the middle here you have the bulk, and we are going to have the significant difference, you know, between the mazhabs, you know, in considering these matters. Yes.
Where is the ayah
that you mentioned? And this in Surah Al-An'am number 106 or 7. So we'll have break now, inshallah.
So brothers and sisters, we will just break for 10 minutes and feel free to discuss what was presented. Indeed, it was heavy, so inshallah, in 10 minutes we will reconvene.